Speaker is Johan Elbaz from Biotechnology and Life Sciences. I'll just make a brief note before he opens his presentation. So students that did not put up their flash presentations will take 2 minutes break after the next speaker, so you'll have a chance to upload your presentations. Thank you.
Okay. So hi everybody, I'm a new PI in the biotechnology department. Just come back from MIT a few months ago. And what I will describe today is mainly, can we manipulate cells, living organisms, to produce nanostructures in the cell? So the question is, can we manipulate them to do structures that are completely artificial, meaning that it's something that the cell do not know to do? Can we manage to manipulate and bring different kind of organisms, different kind of functions from different kind of biological place, put them together using what we call genetic program, and synthesize these kind of nanostructures? Now, the main reason that we are doing these kind of things is by two. First of all, we want to produce these nanostructures at bulk very cheaply. And the second, we want to create new in vivo application. And if I'm just coming back to the plenary talk that said that once it was difficult to synthesize DNA, so this is what I will call the revolution of synthetic biology, that today we can synthesize huge genes, we can manipulate them and assemble them with very sophisticated technique, and this is the reason that today we are able to get in this kind of fields. But let's start with different kind of examples of what biology already knows to do. So nature already creates magnetic particles in bacteria. We have here the diatoms that envelop themselves into silica. We have spiders that create silk. And the main question is not only if we can reproduce the same thing, can we manipulate the genes to control the size of the magnetic particles, but can we even discover completely new materials? And to do these kind of things, you need mainly three things. You need to be able to manipulate many genes together, so you need genetic circuits. You need to be able to control them on times, meaning oscillators or different kind of feedbacks. And you need to control also everything, where it's going to happen. And this is why synthetic biology come in. So this is a field that started 10 years ago, 15 years ago, when the idea was to put together engineers and to have a new language that will enable us to manipulate the cells. So what these great scientists have done during all of these years is they create new parts, new genetic parts, that will enable us to assemble them in a way that will be fast and robust. We can synthesize the DNA, so it's cheap and relatively accessible to everybody today. And you can just transform the cell according to the host cell that you want to use it. So if it's bacteria to produce materials, or it is human cells that you want to do it, something therapeutic, plants can be agriculture, and so on. But just to understand the complexity to do these kind of things, if this is the bacteria, so the living organisms, what will we do? An engineer, in electrical engineering, will start to put programs and plan them. He will be able to control the place of this chip. But unfortunately, the cell looks more like something like this. So it's a big balagan, if we say in Hebrew, and we need to be able to do very specifically to control the program and to do what we want in this kind of things. So let's start with just a very simple example of how do we control genes, just to the engines that everybody will be in the same place. So we do have what we call a promoter. We have the RNA polymerase that will recognize the part and will just transcript and express the protein. So where that we can put this kind of gene off, we'll have here a new gene that express a molecule, a peptide that will bind to the DNA and will prevent from the RNA polymerase to bind and to express. So we have the same gene with a repressor that prevents him to be expressed, meaning that we have an off state. If we'll induce a cell, we'll induce with a signal that comes from the outside. So we're able to control this kind of signal. These small molecules can bind to this peptide and prevent back this peptide to bind to the DNA by meaning that the RNA polymerase will be activated. So in a simple way, we can just activate or deactivate the genes using external stimulus. So in just to summarize what people have done during all of these years, you have any kind of way to activate this kind of genes. You have light, you have toxin, antibodies, pH, temperature, so you have a full library of ways that we can manipulate them. This is an example of the ways that we can activate it with light. So you can see that by controlling the intensity, we can control the expression of the protein. And this is just a nice picture of bacteria that you can induce locally, very specific where you want, and you can see that you have the nice Einstein bacteria plate. But let's start with what I want to do. So what do I want to create in these cells? What is the material, the molecule that I want to, the cell to do? So this is what I want them to do, DNA. It's confusing. DNA is doing this kind of genetic worlds. So I'm not talking about DNA as a double strand and the genetic part, but I'm talking DNA as oligos that do nanostructures. So this is a field called DNA nanotechnology, start with Ned Simmons from New York University, with the idea that you can use DNA, not as a gene, but as a polymer that you may assemble, and this makes a huge impact for the nano world, as if you can put what you want, where you want, and manipulate and program all these oligos. Just to make people to understand how does it work, so you may synthesize oligo, control the way that they will assemble, the way that the hybridization will work on, so it's not just regular duplex, they are very complex duplex, crossover junction, a different kind of holiday junction. You can even add sticky ends at this kind of structures, then they will start to assemble and create two-dimensional structure. Today you can do any structure that you want. They can be two-dimensional, they can be three-dimensional structures, you even have programs. So you come to the program, you design the structure that you want to get, and you will get a pool of oligo that you just need to order. So this is a program. You just add in the program. This is called DNA origami. This is very simple to create and to do whatever you want with this kind of field. Now for applications, what people have seeking about it, so for a chemist part, they use it as a scaffold. So I said what I think nano is meaning that you can put what you want where you want at the nanoscales. So using this DNA, you will be able to put different enzymes, put them precisely where you want, and they will create a nice cascade. Or you can synthesize even, use it for organic chemistry and synthesize very specific molecules at a very low concentration. Another thing that you can do is use DNA as a nanomachines. So you can not only use them as statics, they are not just statics, you can even move stuff where you want. This is one of the work that I was involved in my PhD, where we are able to move nanoparticles, single nanoparticles, and to control the precise dimension of and distance between the nanoparticles, control the physical properties, plasmodic and so on. You can even cook inorganic materials in this kind of origami stuff. So meaning if the origami is circular, you will get a circular silver. If it's triangle, you get a triangle silver. So you can even start to think about synthesis of inorganic materials. And if this is for the world of biology, you can definitely use as a drug delivery system. When you have your antibodies in the DNA nanostructures, only when it will arrive close to the cells, they will open itself, release a drug, and kill the cell. Now, my question, and this is mainly my topic and what I'm doing, can we do these things in the cell? Can we genetically modify the cell, introduce new genetic program, and they will start to synthesize what we call DNA nanostructures? So what we want to have a bacteria, we will have our new genes, we'll induce it using light or different kind of molecules, the way that you described, they will synthesize single-strand DNA. This single-strand DNA will be able to assemble together. You may think about manufacturing, imaging, or intracellular scaffolding, or all what you want is just to purify the oligos and make it cheaper. I know that I say that it's cheap to make DNA today, but I talk about genes, oligos, when we need oligos, we're talking about hundreds of oligos, highly purified for DNA origami, the price is still high. So even that is doing something nice, sophisticated, like the drug delivery, still the price of this drug delivery system is quite expensive. So if we will have a bacteria that will produce these full structures, we'll reduce the price and make it maybe affordable for people. But the question is, how do we move from here to here? This is not trivial, since we are talking about introducing new genes, and we want from the biology, we want from this bacteria to create single-strand DNA. This is not a normal process, this is not a natural process to do this kind of things. We do have nucleotides, obviously, in the cell, but can we arrange the nucleotide in the way that they will create oligos? We also want that this program will be precise. We want to control the precise 5'-3'. We want to this system to create and produce any DNA that we want. We don't want to come again to the program anytime that we want a very specific oligo and try to retune the system. And so we want something very general, and we want to have a system that can do multiple single-strand DNA in the same time. So this is the three things that we want from this system to do. So as I said, what we have today is a huge database of a lot of research that was done in biology, with a lot of database that you can too simply start to look what different kind of organisms may help us to do these kind of things. So what the HIV is doing. So yes, the HIV is a bad guy, but it can be used also as a good guy. So in this case, we have the HIV capsules and introduce an RNA, and it's coming with an enzyme called the reverse transcriptase. What this enzyme is doing is taking the viral RNA and reverse it to DNA. Then this DNA is integrated into the genome, and this is a way of infection. See, in another world, we do have a way that we can move from RNA to DNA. So there is a function that I can use, basically, that I will be able to program an RNA to be my single-strand DNA. So I will start to talk about a little bit of molecular biology. This can be a little bit boring for a lot of people, but this is a way that this is going to work, so I must show and describe the system. So we do have the viral RNA. We have a tRNA that it is in the eukaryotes. So this is a natural tRNA. This blue part binds to this blue part. So the enzyme recognizes this specific duplex. So it's a duplex of RNA. And it starts to polymerize DNA on an RNA template. So this is what makes this enzyme and this virus very special. They can polymerize DNA on an RNA template. This is all the world of virus. This is why they are so sophisticated. The second thing that they are doing, they are removing the RNA. Here, this is RNA, this is DNA. So it's removing the RNA from the duplex, and it's producing DNA. Now it's doing this two times, and in this way, it's creating this double-strand DNA that is integrated into the genome. Now the question is, can we use synthetic biology to manipulate the cells to make this kind of molecular synthesis? When we are going to stop it here, we want to have single-strand DNA, we don't want to have it two times. And the second question is, may it work in bacteria? So until now, you don't have a literature that shows that the HIV infects bacteria. So we don't know if the reverse transcriptase coming from the HIV is working over there. So the first thing that we made is, what we don't have in the bacteria, we don't have the tRNA. So we don't have the complex that takes the enzyme to the substrate. So let's engineer a terminator for the people that don't know what the terminator. So we have the RNA polymerase, and the way that is finishing the transcription is because we have a terminator. So why not to take this natural product structure, conjugate the 5' and 3' together, in this way we'll have a non-coding RNA that will be transcript and terminate with the binding part for the HIV. So in this way, if what is missing is a tRNA, we'll make it and produce it exactly in the non-coding RNA that we want. Now, the important part is we're going to produce DNA only on this non-coding RNA. We are not producing tRNA that is free and will not have any kind of non-desired reverse transcription system. So how to engineer a terminator? We are taking a cassette, we have a GFP and RFP. If the sequence here is a terminator, we'll have high level of GFP, low level of RFP. This is what you can see here. So this is a control. If you don't have terminator, you have high level of GFP and high level of RFP. This is a very strong terminator, natural from bacteria. So you have high level of GFP, low level of RFP. And this is this tRNA. So this is this very specific structure. So you can see high level of GFP and relatively low level of RFP, meaning that we can, first of all, engineer the RNA to terminate with this very specific structure. The second question that we ask ourselves, can we build up a sensor in the cell that will enable us to understand if this process is working? So let's say that we are taking this cassette. We have an RFP, and it's going to be terminated with this HIV terminator binding site. So we are transcripting the RNA. So this is a regular mRNA. In this case, we'll have expression of RFP. So we have the mRNA of RFP. Ribosome will recognize the ribosome binding site, and we'll express RFP. Now, if we will add the HIV to the system, what is going on is going to bind to this part. It will start to polymerize DNA on the mRNA, and it should be reducing the RFP expression. In this way, we'll have a low level of RFP. So this is exactly what you see here. You can see that if we are introducing different kind of HIV structure, you can see a reduced on the expression of the RFP. So what we know at this stage, we knew that we can do a terminator that is the missing part for the HIV. And we knew that the HIV reverse transcript bind to it and is doing something on the mRNA. So if we look at the full process of the single-strand DNA production, so we'll have this cassette. SYNGAS2 DNA will be, this part will be the SYNGAS1 DNA that we want to express, will be terminated with the HTPS, will transcript RNA, the HIV will bind to it, will start to polymerase DNA, we'll have DNA RNA duplex here, it will switch itself into RNase H, will remove the RNA from the DNA, and in this way at the end, what you're doing, you're taking this RNA and you reverse it transcript to DNA. We still have the RNA bind to it, this is something that we need to resolve, but at least we have the SYNGAS2 DNA. If we purified it, you had RNase A, and you have precisely 3 to 5 prime. Now this is didn't work. So just to make it a little bit, what is really the reality in the lab? So we do have the full process when we have this kind of genes that transcript RNA and we hope to see DNA, but when I purified it from the cell, I saw nothing. So I knew that I have this terminator, I knew that I have the RTs that bind and start to do something, but nothing come out. So what's come out at the end is maybe what we don't have is elongation, meaning that we do have the terminator, we do have the HIVs that bind to it, start to make DNA, but maybe it's not doing the full process. So it's just creating few kind of nucleotide, and this is the reason that we see the lower level of RFP. The second possibility is that we don't have the RNase H, so it's not giving us the DNA. So inspired by the way that the RT-PCR is working, for the moment that you have few DNA on it, you can too simply have any kind of reverse transcriptase and it will make the elongation. And if the problem is RNase H, the second RT will just make the resolve the problem. So in this case, we have the terminator that it is for the HIV. The HIV bind to it, and the second RT is going to amplify the signal. And this is works. So you can see the result here. Only if you have the HIV reverse transcriptase and the murine leukemia, you got DNA. In all those other cases, you don't have any DNA. And you can see that if you had only murine leukemia, you don't start the process, so you don't have any DNA too. You can induce the cells, you can control, as I said, by using simple synthetic programs on and off, so you can have or not have DNA. And we were able even to prove that the DNA is DNA with this RNA part. This is why you have a shift here on the DNA. We were able to compare it with commercial oligos. So this is coming from a company. If we are adding here 72 nucleotides, you can see a very precise band at 72. If you change it to 49, you can see the shift, and we get very specific other oligo. Now the question is not only if we do have the oligo, but what is the quality? So we also create a sequencing experiments. So what we used is we add adaptators to the SYNGAS2 DNA. And in this, we were able to sequence our DNA and to check precisely the base and the precision of the synthesis of the DNA. Now, if we want to create DNA nanostructures, and all what you want is just to purify the oligo and create nanostructures, so we are able to describe that if you had here this very specific sequence, you purified it from the cell and assembled in vitro, you will be able to reproduce precisely the exactly same structures that was done using oligos, that commercial oligos. Now the difference between these two structures is only 10 nucleotides. So this is a single DNA that binds to himself and create nanowires, but if you add 10 base in between them, it's creating a two-dimensional nanostructures. So you can see how precise is even our system that is creating exactly the DNA that we want, and we do not see here two-dimensional, we don't see any one-dimensional nanowire. Now the second question is, can we assemble these nanostructures in the cell? This is a very important question because we do not know if oligos may assemble in the environment of bacteria. So what we have here is a program that expresses 4 DNA in the same time. So we have 1, 2, 3, 4 are oligo that are with the system of the HIV and the murine leukemia. When they're going to assemble one to another, they're going to create what we call a crossover junctions. So it's a very important structure that we are using in DNA nanotechnology to create nanostructures. When I purified it from the cell, I was able to see this X structure. So this is the DNA. I keep the RNA at the end to enable me and myself to visualize it using AFM, so you can see precisely the X. But still, I didn't prove that they are assembling in the cell. Maybe all what is happening here is that I'm creating 4 DNA, 4 different oligos. They do assemble to this structure, but maybe they assemble when I'm purifying the structures. When I'm coming to the purifying the structures, I have the 4 oligos, and they somehow assemble to themselves. And this is why I was able to visualize some nanostructures. So we put on a DNA nanostructures in vivo sensor. So what do we have here? We have this very specific nanostructure, the same crossover junctions, but what we introduce into it is zinc finger domains, by meaning that if the structure will form, they will reassemble split YFP, and only if the full structure is assembled, they will reconstitute YFPs, meaning that we are going to have fluorescence only if we have the structure. Now you can see here, one part, one DNA, you don't get any fluorescence. Two DNA, they will assemble, but they don't create any kind of zinc finger parts. If you have three DNA, they will create one of them, but you don't have the second one here, so no fluorescence. If you have the four part together, they will reassemble precisely the structure, put zinc finger together, close to each other. It means that the YFP is going to be bind to them and reconstitute, and we got high level of fluorescence. If you put some mutation on the zinc finger, you don't get any fluorescence. If you don't have the HIV, you don't even get any fluorescence. We're able to follow the time process of this full system, so it's not exactly, I would say, a DNA sensor only for DNA. We do have the enzymes that by itself is going to increase the stability of the structures. But we are at least able to visualize the dynamics of these structures with the enzyme on it. So you can see here that after 8 hours, we do see the second population, 6 hours. This is a population of cells that do have the YFP on it. And we were able also to visualize different kind of stability of structures and see that more stable they are, more YFP we got. So to summarize what I just described, that we can today, using synthetic biology, using what we called easy way to manipulate cell, introduce new functions. We can do DNA in the cell. We can start to take nanostructures, something that you may be have in your mind, and start to think about doing it in the cell. If we think about the future, we can definitely use now these structures, doing the nano in the cell and start to manipulate the cell, put what we want where we want, so we can do scaffolding. It's going to be better than RNA because they're going to be stable. RNA are not stable in the cell. If we are thinking about sRNA, so what I just described to the event, that you have this sRNA drug delivery system, maybe we can do it all in the cell. And we can even, when the cell is, or the bacteria is going to be close to the cancer cell or in the microbiome, they're going to inject this kind of drug delivery system. So we can control it by the environment. We can use it with super resolution imaging. DNA now today is a very sophisticated technique to do imaging. We can too simply use now, having the DNA produced inside, we're going to be able to tag what we want and where we want. So I hope that I described and demonstrate to you that we can do our nano in the biology. I was a chemist, nothing to do with the biology until my postdoc, meaning that you don't need to be a biologist to be involved today in synthetic biology. You can be with a different background. We're looking for people with different backgrounds that connect together to do what we want in the cell. So as I'm a new PI, we have 4 people that choose to join the lab, and I'm definitely looking for other people. So pass the message. I'm looking for postdoc, PhD, and masters. Thank you.
Very nice, Johan. So a few questions. So one thing is, what about mechanisms, the mechanisms in the cell that don't like to have a single strand DNA, right? Is that an issue?
It's an issue.
And also, when you want to construct some of these structures, sometimes you have to control the concentrations in the, the salt concentration and so on. So how do you kind of plan to address that in the future?
Okay, for the first question, you are right. Cells do not like single strand DNA. This is virus. So the good part is we can manipulate the genome. We can just take off all the SOS system and the RecA. So in this way, they're going to be stable. They don't have the exonucleus. So this is a good part. If you are doing something that is non-natural and the cell do not really need, you can manipulate the cell as compared to the RNA part that will be always under degradation system. So this is for the first question. For the second question, yes, I think that we maybe will not be able to do any structures that we are able to do in vitro, but what we can definitely use is start to use evolution to push the cell to do it. There is different ways that you may think out of the box. That is not the way that even chemists were seeking to do it, but let's push the cell to do it, that they will not have a choice that to create these nanostructures. Now, the complexity, I don't know where we'll be able, where we're going to arrive at the end.
Any other question? Okay, thank you, Johan.